It is especially fitting that we acknowledge Australia's local Indigenous community and pay our respects. This is something that the late Professor Edward Said would have endorsed, appreciated and encouraged. For decades he advanced, or advocated rather, for the enslaved, the colonised, the oppressed and the dispossessed. His work and writings were embraced by many. It was a universal language in many ways as it resonated with many global citizens. It also outraged some, which in turn facilitated the rise of a new discipline, post-colonial studies. It provided agency to many former colonial subjects to take ownership of their rights. Born in Jerusalem in 1935, Edward Said was many things to different people. Known as a Palestinian-American academic, a political activist and commentator, a literary critic, a musician and a cultural theorist. To the Palestinian people, he was viewed as a respected, articulate, successful human, embodying what the state of Palestine could have been if they hadn't been dealt the hand they were 100 years ago, when the land of Palestine was promised by the British Foreign Secretary, Lord Balfour, which allowed the establishment of Israel in 1948. Said was an outspoken proponent of the Palestinian state, as well as the political rights of the political rights and aspirations of the Palestinian people. These themes and others have in fact been examined these last couple of days here on campus at the Palestine and the West History, Contemporary Realities and Challenges Ahead Symposium. Tomorrow is our final day and we'll be addressing the challenges ahead. Gideon Levy will be involved in a panel discussion tomorrow afternoon. So if you're inspired to hear more from him and our other presenters, please look up the AFOPA website and you can register online. And I also understand we have some of the booking sheets outside in the foyer. His, as in Edward Said's, books about the Middle East include The Question of Palestine, Covering Islam, How the Media and the Experts Determine How We See the Rest of the World, Blaming the Victims, and he also co-edited the book, The Politics of Dispossession. He's written many other books, but the ones that made him most famous, or infamous, depending on which camp you find yourselves in, is Orientalism and Culture and Imperialism. It gives me great pride to be affiliated with the Department of Politics and International Studies and the university at large. They have actively hosted and supported this annual lecture for the last 12 years. Because of the immense contribution Said has made to the field of literature, cultural studies, and Middle Eastern studies, it was only deemed appropriate that an annual lecture recognise the impact he as an individual and as an intellect has made. The annual Edward Said Memorial Lecture, co-hosted by the University of Adelaide and AFOPA, the Australian Friends of Palestine Australia, has brought a range of distinguished speakers to Australian audiences since its inauguration in 2005. Some past speakers have included Professor Noam Chomsky, journalist Robert Fisk, Dr. Mustafa Barghouti, Tariq Ali, Professor Saria Makhdisi, Dr. Sarah Roy, Professor Ilan Pape, and the late Professor Tanya Reinhardt. This event could not have been possible without the hard work of Professor Bassam Dalli, founder of the ESML, as well as a focus speaker subcommittee, workers at the Palestine Centre for Peace located on Frome Street, a group of dedicated volunteers, and the generous support and sponsorship of AFOPA. Before I hand over to Dr. Shaheen, I would like to quickly go through a few housekeeping matters. Can I kindly ask that you switch your phones off or put them onto silent? In the case we need to evacuate, as you can see, there are multiple evacuation exits, one on my left and my right, and then through the doors that you came through. There are also bathroom facilities in the foyer. So the Australian Friends of Palestine Association is a not-for-profit community organisation based in South Australia, actively engaged in advocacy for a just peace between Palestine and Israel. To introduce our 2017 ESML speaker, award-winning journalist Gideon Levy, I would like to introduce Dr. Sam Shaheen to say a few words about FOPA and introduce our esteemed speaker. Thank you.
I make the case to you that as responsible Australians, we have the privilege, the right, and the moral obligation to be concerned about the plight of the Palestinian people, just as we should be concerned about the plight of any peoples dispossessed or oppressed. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am a proud Australian. I was born to Palestinian parents who in turn trace their Palestinian roots to generations before them. My father, the late Fred Shaheen, was born and raised in Safar, in the north of Palestine. My mother was born at Haifa, also in the north of Palestine. In 1948, their respective families fled on foot for weeks, eventually settling in a makeshift refugee camp in South Lebanon. They were amongst the hundreds of thousands of Palestinians that were displaced in 1948. The Australian Friends of Palestine Association is a voluntary, not-for-profit organisation which has as its primary objective the promotion of peace in Palestine based on international law and United Nations resolutions. It was established in 2004, and I acknowledge our inaugural chairman and our patron of the association, Mr. Paul Hayward Smith QC, who's with us tonight. AFOPA promotes peace, justice, freedom, and equality for everyone. We do so through advocacy, education, provision of resource materials, and through the recently established Palestine Centre for Peace here in downtown Adelaide. In essence, and from afar here in Australia, AFOPA supports the aspirations of the Palestinian people to live in peace, to enjoy basic human rights, to have freedom and freedom of movement in a safe environment, and to have economic opportunity. And today is about appealing to you as extraordinary Australians to judge for yourself whether you can accept human rights abuses wherever they may be in the world. So why Palestine? Palestine has been described as one of the most critical conflicts of the last 100 years. And one of the most critical to world peace. The Palestinian issue is not a religious struggle. Religion has little to do with it, in fact. Religion is abused by those that use it as an excuse for their means. Palestine is a human rights issue. It is a struggle against dispossession of a people. The Palestinian people that have now lived under Israeli occupation for over 69 years. The Palestinian population is currently estimated at 11 million, half of which are classified as refugees by the United Nations. Nobody in the world, nobody in history, has ever gotten their freedom by appealing sense of the people who were oppressing them. Nobody in the world has ever gotten their freedom by appealing sense of the people who were oppressing them. There is much wisdom in the statement. And the Palestinians need your help. Palestine's right to self-determination is not, in international law, subject to any performance criteria stipulated by Israel. No other oppressed people have had their right to self-determination made conditional on the preference of the occupier. If you, like the Friends of Palestine, cannot tolerate discrimination, then you are already an advocate of the Palestinian people. And if you, like the Palestinian people, if you, like the Friends of Palestine, cannot tolerate racism, then you are already an advocate to Palestinian rights as well. No one who cherishes the value of human dignity freedom, equality and justice can walk away from the Palestinian cause. And AFOPA, like other wonderful organisations such as APAN, the Australia-Palestine Advocacy Network, have taken on the difficult role of advocating for the just rights of the Palestinians. I acknowledge the entire executive of APAN, and in particular its president, the tireless Bishop George Brownham, for their outstanding efforts, and they have travelled from all over Australia to be with us this weekend. Archbishop Desmond Tutu said, "If you are neutral in situations of injustice, then you have chosen the side of the oppressor." If you are neutral, even if you are neutral, doing nothing is not an option. Help us help those less fortunate than ourselves, and help organisations like AFOPA to continue their good work for the Palestinians. Ladies and gentlemen, I will now introduce our guest speaker of the 13th Edward Said Memorial Lecture, Mr. Gideon Levy. Mr. Levy is an eminent Israeli journalist and commentator whose weekly column for the newspaper Haaretz often focuses on the Israeli occupation of the Palestinian territories. Mr. Levy was born in Tel Aviv. In 1974, he was drafted into the Israeli Defense Force, where he served as a reporter for Israeli Army Radio. Between 1978 and 1982, he worked as an aide to Shimon Peres, then leader of the Israeli Labor Party. In 1982, he began to write for the Israeli daily Haaretz. In 2004, Mr. Levy published a compilation of articles entitled Twilight Zone, Life and Death Under the Israeli Occupation. His weekly talk show, A Personal Meeting with Gideon Levy, was broadcast on Israeli cable TV. Mr. Levy defines himself as a patriotic Israeli. He criticizes what he sees as Israeli society's moral blindness to the effects of its acts of war and occupation. He has referred to the construction of settlements on private Palestinian land as the most criminal enterprise in Israel's history. Mr. Levy supports unilateral withdrawal from occupied Palestinian territories without concessions. His views on Israel's policies toward the Palestinians evolved after joining Haaretz. And I quote Mr. Levy, "When I first started covering the West Bank for Haaretz, I was young and brainwashed," he said in an interview. "I would see settlers cutting down olive trees and soldiers mistreating Palestinian women at the checkpoints. And I would think, these are exceptions, not part of government policy. It took me a long time to see that these were not exceptions, they were the substance of government policy." Mr. Levy was a supporter of a two-state solution, but he argues that it has become untenable and now supports the alternative one-state solution. He supports boycotting Israel, saying it is the Israeli patriots' final refuge. Mr. Levy has said that economic boycott is more important, but that he also supports academic and cultural boycott. Mr. Levy has published The Twilight Zone, Life and Death Under the Israeli Occupation, and The Punishment of Gaza by Versa Books in 2010, and copies of that will be available outside after the lecture. Mr. Levy's writing has earned him numerous accolades and awards, described as a powerful liberal voice by the New York Times and labelled as a heroic Israeli journalist by The Independent. He has been awarded the Emil Brunswick Human Rights Award in 1996 by the Association for Civil Rights in Israel, the Leipzig Media Award in 2003, the Euromed Journalist Prize for Cultural Dialogue in 2007, Peace Through Media Award at the International Media Awards in 2012, and the Olof Palm Prize, shared with Palestinian pastor Mitri Rahim for their fight against occupation and violence peace in 2016. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Gideon Levy.
I can hardly recognize myself. Were you really talking about me? Did I say all those reasonable things? I can't hardly believe it. You don't know how excited I am here today. First of all, to be in Australia. A very old dream of me and my partner, Katrin, became true. And this by itself is almost a miracle. And we'll get to miracles later. Secondly, Australia not only answered all our expectations after 3 days here, it is far beyond our expectations. And our expectations were very high. So we are really, really happy to be here. Not less than this, I'm excited to be with you tonight here, commemorating the late Professor Edward Said. I carry many guilt feelings toward the Palestinian people, the Nakba, the occupation, not knowing Arabic, even though I did anything possible to learn Arabic. And the last scene is that I never had this opportunity to meet Professor Said in person. I have the feeling that we would have seen most of the things eye to eye, and I really feel it as a loss, as a personal loss, not to have the opportunity to meet this great man. And in a way, it is closing a circle tonight here in Australia to held the annual lecture, the 13th annual lecture. 13 brings a lot of luck according to Judaism. According to other beliefs, it's not a very lucky number, but I'm so proud to do it tonight. And last but not least, to see this crowd. I mean, I could never have such a crowd in Tel Aviv. Never, ever. To see so many knowledgeable people here, so far away, and still caring so much, and so knowledgeable about what's going on so far away. So I would like to thank, first of all, Dr. Bassam Dali, who brought us here, who made the first connection to organize this unforgettable tour. We are just in the beginning, but if it will go on like this, I will never leave. And all the other good people who were organizing this tour. Ambassador Afif Safia said this morning in one of the sessions that only optimists make history. So I guess, Afif, that I'm not going to make history. But I'll do my best to find some kind of hope, but I'm not sure that optimism is my first characteristic. But I'll do my best, only for you. A word about myself. I was born in Tel Aviv, as you just heard. I was brought up in Tel Aviv. I was a typical product of the Israeli education system, the Israeli media. I was a good boy, Tel Aviv. I believed everything they told us. I believed that we are the weak ones, the small ones, the victims. And the Arabs are the strong ones. We are the David, they are the Goliath. I believe that all the Arabs all over the world have only one thing in their mind, and this is to throw off the ocean. They were born to kill. They wake up in the morning only with one thought, how to get rid of the Jews. Until I was 18 or 20, I never heard the word Nakba. Never heard about it. I saw those ruins along Israel. I never asked, what are those ruins? I had in mind that they had something to do with the past, but there were no sign, nothing. I knew nothing about it. I really believe that we are the right ones and they are the wrong ones. We are the good ones and they are the bad ones, without any compromises. I truly believe that we are always in an existential danger, and they are all demons. And it was quite late. You mentioned all my sins, not only serving in the army, but also working for Shimon Peres, which in many ways is much a bigger sin. I truly believe that labor is for peace. Shimon Peres is a man of peace. Israel wants peace. We say shalom. What is more than this? Urging for peace. Our greeting is peace. Can you think about the more peaceful nation which greets each other with the word peace? Can it be more than this? The only thing we want is peace, and this occupation was forced on us. And I believed in all this until in the late 80s, after I finished all my sins, I started totally incidentally to go to the West Bank without any agenda. And gradually, week after week, months after months, I realized two things. I realized that this is the biggest drama of Israel, and I realized that there is no one in Israeli media, or almost no one, to tell it. To tell it, first of all, to the Israelis who don't want to know and who don't know about what's going on their behalf, half an hour away from their homes. And there are so many agencies which help them not to know. And that's the main issue of my lecture today. How is it possible that after 50 years, the first 50 years, Israelis live so much in peace with the occupation? Israelis have so little question marks and so little doubts about what's going on half an hour away from their homes. How come that the people or a state which sends missions, rescue missions to any catastrophe in the world, they are always the first one with field hospitals, with rescue teams in earthquakes, in floods, everywhere? How come they are so blind about what's going on their behalf, under their control, 20 minutes away from their homes? How can it be that the people, which some of you know Israelis, they are not monsters, at least the majority of them, at least some of them are not monsters. People with some kind of values, how can they live in peace with this brutality? People, you know, an old lady will try to cross a road in Tel Aviv or in Jerusalem, they will help her to cross the road many times, even if she doesn't want to cross the road. People with values. How can it be that these people live so much in peace with this ongoing cry which started in 48, not in 67, and never stopped? Never stopped. Because for people like me, and that's something else that I learned throughout my years covering the occupation, over 30 years now, that the Nakba never stopped. And we have to remember this. It's not like the Nakba is a war of crime, which was sometimes 60, 70 years ago, and now we face a new reality, by all means not. It never stopped. Israel is a very unique phenomena, and in this time I don't mean it only from the good aspect, but it's a very interesting phenomena. It's the only state I know which possesses three regimes. Not one regime, not two regimes, three regimes. We are having quite a liberal democracy for its Jewish citizens. This democracy is now facing many challenges with the current government, legislations which are anti-democratic, one after the other. But still, one can define the regime which is aimed at the Jewish citizens of Israel as a liberal democracy. I have total freedom to express my views. The second regime, as you know, is the regime aimed at the Palestinian citizens of Israel, around 20% of Israeli citizenship. Formally, they enjoy all the rights of citizens, they vote, they can be elected, freedom of movement, but they are deeply, deeply discriminated in any possible field. I will not get into it, but I guess some of you know about it. They are the second regime of Israel. And the third regime of Israel is obviously the occupation, the military occupation in the occupied territories, Gaza and the West Bank, which is today, and I'm very careful in what I say, which is today one of the most brutal tyrannies on earth. Not less than this. There are very few brutal, tyrannous, totalitarian regimes like the regime in the occupied territories. And one should face it. And no state which possesses such a tyranny in its backyard can be perceived as a democracy. No way. You can't be half pregnant either you are pregnant or you are not. Unfortunately so, many times. And you can't be half democratic. And if you possess this regime in your backyard, and this regime is not a temporary regime, let's face it. We are facing now 50 years without any signs that it's going to come to its end. On the contrary, we are today farther from the end of occupation than 20 years ago. And we are getting farther and farther because there is no status quo, because Israel is creating an irreversible reality on the ground. So, with three regimes, in the front, this only democracy in the Middle East, and in the dark backyard, a totalitarian military regime, which has its phases. There are better times and worse times, but there is not one single day in which life under occupation is something that any one of you can even imagine. No one of us can imagine what does it mean to wake up in a Palestinian village or in a Palestinian town, even in peaceful times like now. No one of us had, except of those who live there, can really imagine himself. What does it mean in terms of time consuming, in terms of dignity, in terms of violence, in terms of fears, in terms of freedom, obviously, in terms of the most basic human rights. And this is going on now for 50 years without seeing any end to it. And again, I'm asking, how can it be that the Israeli society is living in peace with this? And here I would like to suggest a few explanations based on what I see as the basic values of Israeli society, Israeli Jewish society. The first value that we were all raised on is the belief, which is valid for seculars and obviously religious people, that we are the chosen people. Not all of us will admit it. Many of us are very liberal and we say, no, no, we are not chosen people. But if you scratch under the skin, you will see that this is a very deep-rooted belief. We are better. We know better. Nobody will tell us what to do. Because we are different, because we are the chosen people. The international law is something wonderful. It was established after World War II, what is more than this. It applies to any country, but it cannot apply to Israel. Because we are different, because we are special. Because international law cannot apply to Israel, because Israel is a special case. The second set of beliefs speaks about we as the victims. Maybe there were worse occupations in history. For sure there were longer occupations, even though the Israeli occupation is long enough. But there was never an occupation in which the occupier perceived himself as the victim. Let's remember what the late, unforgettable Golda Meir said once. We will never forgive the Palestinians for forcing us to kill their children. We kill their children, but we are the victims. And this victimization, which is deep-rooted, obviously, in the history, makes most of the Israelis believe that the Holocaust was not only the biggest tragedy in history, which it was, but the only tragedy in history. And as such, we the victims, back again to Mrs. Golda Meir, who say that after the Holocaust, the Jews have the right to do whatever they want. Again, this enables us, this freedom, to believe that we have the right to do whatever we want because we are not the biggest, not only the biggest victims, but the only victims in history. Try to call the Armenian genocide the Holocaust. Israelis will become aggressive. How can you dare to use the same word? This is only ours, nobody else. And what is the conclusion out of the Holocaust? We are sending now tens of thousands of Israelis to Auschwitz, students, high school students, year after year. And what is the message? One would expect the message should be Auschwitz never again, in terms that never will a people be a victim to those crimes and atrocities. No, this is not the message that we deliver to our young generation. The message is that we should stand and fight and base everything on force, because the whole world is against us and will always be against us. I'll get to it later. And the next set of beliefs, which is connected to the two others, and here I'll be again careful in what I say, but after 64 years of living among Israelis, which is not always great fun, sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't, but I'm deeply convinced that most of the Israelis, if not all of them, left and right, religious and seculars, deep in their heart, deep under their skin, they don't perceive the Palestinians as equal human beings like them. They're not exactly the same. They don't love their children like we do love our children. They don't appreciate life like we appreciate lives. They were born to kill, finally. They are cruel. They are inhuman. They are not exactly like us. This is very efficient, because if they are not human beings like us, so what is this all discourse about human rights? We are not dealing with human beings like us. I remember one case which really hit me many, many years ago in the first Intifada, when I was standing in a checkpoint next to Jenin, trying to get out of the city, and there was an ambulance in front of me. Sorry, it was the second Intifada. There was a Palestinian ambulance standing in front of me, and I stopped after the ambulance. Jenin was under total siege, and I see the soldiers are playing backgammon in the tent. Those times, checkpoints look different than today. I waited 15 minutes, 20 minutes. After half an hour, I really lost my patience, and I went out and asked the Palestinian driver of the ambulance what's going on. He said, that's always the way. We have to wait here like 1 hour before they come to us. And he had this red light and everything. And this I couldn't take anymore, and I went into the tent and I start screaming, as I know, at the soldiers. And what really drove them crazy was the moment in which I asked them, what would have happened if your father would have been in this ambulance? And this drove them crazy, not because it was a provocation, because how dare I to compare their father to the man or woman who was lying in this ambulance? How can you compare it all? And there I really got this idea that they are incapable of perceiving the Palestinians as equal human beings. And this is very deep-rooted, and don't underestimate it. It is maybe the biggest obstacle for any kind of settlement. Because as long as we will not change this, nothing will change. Israelis don't perceive Palestinians as equal human beings. And there are so many agencies which help them to do so. And above all, the Israeli media, obviously. A free media, almost totally private-owned, which is dehumanizing and demonizing the Palestinians over the years in a systematic way. Don't read opinion pieces. They might be very liberal opinion pieces. I'm talking about the stream of information. This is what really shapes the consciousness and the awareness of a people. Look at how they cover and don't cover the occupation. Look how they cover and don't cover the Palestinians. I'm always mentioning this example, which is an extreme example, and I was very criticized for mentioning this example, but I can't help it. I have to bring it out because it is a typical example, even though it is exaggerated. In one of the operations in Gaza, there were two Israeli dogs killed. One dog with the soldiers in Gaza, and the other dog from a Qassam rocket in Sderot, in a private home. Both dogs got front page coverage in Israeli media. Photo images, soldiers telling us how clever and faithful were the dogs, names. The soldier crying over the dog, the owner of the dog is the road. I don't remember all the details, but they had front page coverage. In the same days, obviously it was days of war, there were tens of Palestinians killed. There was something about it. Page 14, page 13, tens of Palestinians were killed those days every day. Now just think about the message. You don't have to, you don't need any opinion pages. It's enough to see it, to, especially if it's on a daily basis, systematically, year after year. The Palestinians have no faces, no names. They are never evicted. They are always the bad ones. The only image that an Israeli can see today in Israeli media would be the Palestinian terrorist, or the one who is suspected as terrorist. This terrorist of 13 who went to the checkpoint and took out scissors, she will be presented as a terrorist. No name, nothing, no story, nobody will have an interest. What brought a girl of 13 to go to the checkpoint with scissors in her hands? And obviously no questions, why should she be executed? But this systematic demonization and dehumanization is maybe the biggest crime of Israeli media over the years. A very good media, a very courageous media in many other fields. They brought prime ministers and ministers and a president to justice. We had the president in jail and a prime minister in jail and ministers in jail, mainly because of a very courageous media. But when it comes to the occupation, you face a total different game. Because we don't want to bother our readership and we don't want to ask questions or make them ask questions which we don't want them to ask questions, because they will not read us and not watch us. If we will raise up the truth, they will just be annoyed, and we don't want to annoy them. We want to please them only because of commercial reasons. And what is the biggest joke in Israel? The biggest joke in Israel, that the Israeli media is very often attacked as being a leftist mafia. Yes, some of the journalists, maybe most of the journalists are leftist. I don't know, who cares? But the job they are doing is really a job of collaboration with the Zionist narrative without having any room for any other narrative. And obviously collaborating with the Israeli occupation, not covering it, and when covering it, always in a biased way, always in an inhuman way. And history will judge one day Israeli media for this collaboration. Now, there are no good news in terms of looking at the movement of Israeli society. If you look backwards, the obvious feeling, and you know it all, is that Israel is moving more toward the nationalistic, religious, racist pole. Racism is everywhere today, I guess, including your country. But there are very few places in which racism became politically correct as Israel. Not only toward Palestinians, also toward African asylum seekers. But the fact is that the Israeli society is moving rapidly towards becoming more right-wing, more nationalistic, and more religious. We're having now the most nationalistic and right-wing government ever. But I want to claim here that even though these changes are taking place, they are not necessarily bad news. For the time being, it's very hard to raise an alternative voice in Israel, very hard. There were times in which I needed a bodyguard in the last war in Gaza. I can give you another example which will show you what change we made. I remember in the first Intifada, the first Palestinian woman who gave birth in a checkpoint. It was really an unforgettable story for me. It was in the year of 89 or 88. A woman from Nebi Samuel next to Jerusalem is trying to get to hospital to give birth. One checkpoint, two checkpoints, three checkpoints, they don't let her pass to Jerusalem. Three checkpoints. I couldn't believe this story. Finally, she gave birth in the checkpoint. She begged the soldiers to take the baby to the hospital. They refused. And finally, she walked. It was winter. She walked in the cold night to Augusta Victoria, the hospital, which was 2.5 kilometers away from there. By the time she arrived there, the baby was dead. When I published this story, I can tell you, I don't want to say that Israel was shocked or people were disturbed, but people spoke about it. It even reached a cabinet meeting. And some officers were dismissed from the army. Not much, but still something. Ever since then, I wrote maybe about another 5, 6, 7, maybe 10, I never counted, other women who lost their babies in checkpoints. And never again was it any kind of interest in Israeli society. It was immediately perceived, and what would have been if she would have carried weapons or bombs? And what would you say if she was a terrorist? And what would you say if she would hide under her dress a bomb? This would be the only reactions I could get for such stories. And this showed me how the Israel society is shifting towards an inhuman, there's no other word but inhuman porn. And we are seeing it growing more and more. Incitement is unbelievable. Social media, oh, thanks God we have social media. This makes things much worse because all of a sudden everyone is a journalist and everyone has an opinion. And the sicker you are, the more spread you are. And the atmosphere today is like never before. And therefore, I must say with a lot of sorrow, don't expect for a change from within the Israeli society. It will not come because the Israeli society has no incentive to go for a change. Ignorant about the occupation, not caring about the occupation. Life in Israel, those of you who have been to Israel, have seen it, life in Israel is wonderful. Try to get a table in a restaurant in Tel Aviv. Try to go to the clubs at night. Try to listen to what people are talking about in the cafes and clubs. And you will find that there is a big elephant in the room and nobody looks at this elephant. As if we will not look at the elephant will disappear. Campaigns, one after the other, for the elections to the parliament. Days in which the joke was that two Israelis share three views. Today, three Israelis hardly share one view, and it will be always the nationalistic view. The occupation is not discussed at all, and life is so good. And when brainwash system is so effective, and life is so good, why would Israel go for a change? Who needs this headache with all those settlers? Nobody cares about them, but who wants the headache to evacuate them? And who cares about what happens with the Palestinians? Let us enjoy our next vacation, our new Jeep, our new apartment. Who cares about what's going on around us? And that's the atmosphere. And it's very hard to change this atmosphere. Almost impossible. With levels of ignorance about the occupation. You talk to people, even intelligent people, you can't believe how deep is the ignorance. I remember once a quite famous journalist asked me, what is administrative detention? It means detention in better conditions, isn't it? Go and explain him that it is only a laundry of words, and administrative detention is detention without a trial, which doesn't exist in no democracy in the world. But we live with it. Don't ask questions. There are hundreds now, over 500, I think, who are right now in administrative detention. But The media is helping us to digest even this with a very efficient laundry of words, the whole language of occupation, which Yogi Lad should make a research once about the laundry of words and the language of occupation that we created to ourselves just to feel better with the occupation, and how it is so well spread by the media. And again, nobody is asking a question, what is it, a civil administration? Civil administration sounds so soft. They care for the education, for the sewage, for the rights of the civilians under the occupation. They are so kind, civil administration, while it should be called military occupation. Nothing civil in it and nothing administrative in it. So my claim is that nobody can expect right now any change from within the Israeli society, unless one thing will happen. And unfortunately, that's the only thing which will change. If Israelis will come to the conclusion that the occupation has a too high price and they're not ready to pay it. They are far from it now. But the only way to change it will be only the day that they will feel that they are punished for the occupation, that they pay for the occupation, I don't mean only in money, that they pay a price for the occupation, which they don't at all, none of them. When they will be found accountable, each of us Israelis, not only the government, each of us, when some airlines stopped to fly to Ben Gurion Airport in the last operation in Gaza for 24 hours, Israel almost went crazy, 24 hours. And I thought then that maybe Qantas, but then it was Austrian Airlines who was the first airline to stop flying to Tel Aviv. I thought Austrian Airlines can make peace much better than the American administration. Just stop flying to Tel Aviv for 1 week and the whole occupation is over. Because the Israelis never paid for the occupation. And it's not easy for me to say so, but that's the only way to change this balance, because right now for Israel, it is much a better option to continue the occupation rather than to stop it. For any Israeli politician, it is much a better option to continue the occupation rather than to bring it to its end. They have only to lose right now. And the only way to change it is in the hands of the world. To make Israel accountable, to make Israel pay the price, to make each Israeli pay the price. This will be the only moment in which change will come. Change, unfortunately, will not come through education and not through changing the minds in Israel, because we tried it and we brought us nowhere. It will not go through giving more and more carrots to Israel, as the American administration, the EU, and all the others are trying to tempt Israel. No, we tried this way, it never worked. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I must say, also violence was not an efficient tool, and let's remember this. The Second Intifada, which was really violent, also by the Palestinians, with all the suicide bombers and exploding buses, didn't bring any progress to the Palestinians. Didn't bring. I'm not speaking now about the moral point of view, but even in practical points of view, the Palestinians just lost in this intifada, because we have to face it, Israel is much stronger. And those are not good news. I want to say a word about being a friend of Israel. Friendship to Israel, and this is very, very relevant in this country. Friendship to Israel does not mean blind and automatic support of Israel. Think about your personal friends. Whom do you prefer? Those who support anything you do, or those who know also when to criticize? Think about any relative who is drug addicted. If you will supply him with more money, he will buy more drugs and he will be very grateful to you. Do you really care for him? Are you a real friend? Is it love? Try to send him to a rehabilitation center and he will be so mad at you, but this will be real care. And Israel, let's face it, is so occupation addicted that no money or carrots or support will bring a change. By all means, not. On the contrary, supporting the Israeli policy, in my view, as an Israeli, is not friendship to Israel, is not caring about the future of Israel. By all means, not. By all means, not. Raising a voice for justice is real friendship when it comes to Israel. And here I must say, right now, and again, it's not easy for me to say so, and I didn't say so 2 years ago, but right now, almost the only game in town is BDS. It's not very easy. I wish we wouldn't need it. It is very problematic, but by the end of the day, first of all, boycott is a legitimate tool. Israel is the first one to use it. Israel is calling the whole world to put sanctions on Iran, to boycott Hamas. Israel cannot say that this is not a legitimate tool, by all means not. Is it an effective tool? It was so effective facing South Africa. And we can't ignore the effectiveness or the potential of effectiveness. And in those days, after the Palestinians really tried everything, they tried diplomacy, they tried terror, they tried kidnapping airplanes, they tried really everything. They gave up so much and they tried so much and nothing brought them any kind of progression. And we have to remember, my friends, we are dealing now with the third generation of Palestinians who live under this occupation. They don't have time. Gaza, in 2 years, 2.5 years, in the year of 2020, the UN declared it, not me, the experts of the UN, is going to become a place where human beings will not be able to live it there. It's not that we have time, not that I'm going to suggest you any solutions, but by the end of the day, let's remember, time is very, we have a lot of time for ourselves, but not for the people of Gaza or the people of the West Bank, or the refugees in Yarmouk, or the refugees in Sabra and Shatila, obviously. And we tried, and the Palestinian tried, and nothing brought any progress, I'm afraid to say so. I see the Israeli reaction to the BDS, and that's enough for me to know that that's the game. Because I see how aggressive Israel becomes, how many efforts are now dedicated to fight against BDS, or to fight against any diplomatic initiatives, even of the PA, to go to the criminal law, criminal court, and others. The way that Israel is reacting gives me the hope that this might be effective. And if it will go on like this, it is a source of hope. The hope comes now only from civil societies, only from people like you. Governments are far behind in your country and in many countries, in most of the countries. Let me say very clearly, if there would have been one American president who would have liked to put an end to the occupation would have come to its end within months. Within months, there was never an American president who really meant it. And there was, I must say, never, obviously, an Israeli prime minister who meant to put an end to the occupation. Never, ever. No one of them, including the legendary Peres and Rabin and all the others. They wanted some progress, they wanted some change, they wanted to ease the occupation, but they never meant to put an end to it. None of them. How do I know? Because none of them stopped the settlement project. And there is nobody who built one terrace in the occupied territories a means to put an end to the occupation. It doesn't go together. So when this is the political map, the real hope is the civil societies. And it is working, I must say. And we have really not to give up. And here I come for my last and most problematic chapter, and this is what should we do? And what is the solution? We were facing, from my point of view, a fascinating discussion in the session before between, if I may say so, the older generation, the younger generation of Palestinians over the question of two states, one state. I think we have to leave it to the Palestinians. But I must say here, as frank as I can be, I supported the two-state solution for many years. It's the most logical solution. It is the most reasonable. Two peoples sharing one state, let's separate them. But I'm afraid to say that this is a train that left the station by now. With 700,000 settlers, nobody, no Israeli politician will ever be able to evacuate 700,000 settlers. And without their total evacuation, there is no viable Palestinian state. And without having no viable Palestinian state, we are having another Oslo. And none of us wants another Oslo. Because Oslo, when we look back, I supported Oslo. I was stupid enough and brainwashed enough. When I look backwards, Oslo created only damages. It only strengthened the occupation. The occupation is today much stronger than before Oslo. And the occupation is much more based on the settlement project, almost tripled ever since Oslo. So if we don't want another bluff, another trap, another fiction, we have to ask ourselves, is the two-state solution visible, viable? You can see an Israeli politician evacuating 700,000 settlers. The settlers, which are the most powerful group in Israeli society, the group which is blackmailing one government after the other, would it be Labor or Likud? Who exactly is going to evacuate them? Labor? The founding father of the settlement project? Likud, their great supporters? Who is going exactly to evacuate them and how? We have to realize, my dear friends, they won. The settlers won. And we have to change the discourse, at least we Israelis. We Israelis, and I speak now on behalf of maybe 10 Israelis, not many more. But it's also a beginning, you know? We have to change the discourse and start to speak about equal rights. That's the only way to open up. And I want to see what Israel will say for equal rights. There are two options. One, Israel will say, yeah, wonderful. Equal rights, yeah, it's democratic. It goes without saying, let's go for it. Miracle. Even though, you know, in this part of the world, one should be realistic enough to believe in miracles. This is to you, Afif. We should believe in miracles, and we do. They never happen, that's the only problem. And the second one, Israel, as it is today, will stand on its legs. How dare you? End of Zionism, end of the Jewish state, end of the Zionistic idea. How dare you? And today it's almost impossible even to raise the idea. And then we have to ask the Israelis in a very simple way, what do you want? What do you want, Israelis? My fellow Israelis, what do you want? What is the end of the game? What is your goal? You want to live in a democracy? There is no other democracy but a one-state solution. You want to live in a Jewish state? Perfect, go for the two-state solution, but then you can't live with the occupation. You can't have it both. You can't have it all. You can't eat the cake and leave it complete. You have to make up your mind. And this will be the day when the world will come to Israel and to the Palestinians. But the key is in Israeli heads right now. Will come to Israel, ask Israel, what do you want? And then, if Israel will say neither nor, it is for the world to decide. Can you live in peace with another apartheid state in the 21st century? Aren't you going to do anything about the apartheid state? Because if Israel says no to two-state solution, no to equal rights, Israel declares itself as an apartheid state officially, formally, legally, and then the world will live with it? Can the world live with it? Will the world live with it? And then comes the role of the civil societies to raise their voices and to say, no, we don't agree to this. Will Israel say security? What does this has to do? So by the end of the day, I think that we are in a time in which we have to refresh the discourse, not to stick to the old slogans because they led us to nowhere, not because they were bad or not just, they were just and good, but they led us to nowhere. 50 years, we tried everything. We gained nothing, we got nothing. And we have to ask what will bring us closer, because the Palestinians have no time, because the small minority of Israelis with conscience also want once and for all to live in a place that we will be proud of, which we are not. And therefore, my message tonight is here. Any civil society matters now. Any voice matters, because we are in an era of change, because voices are being listened. Too slow, too late, but it is the only hope right now. Raise your voice to put an end to the occupation. Thank you so much.
History is written by optimists, but he's one realist that is making a contribution with uncompromising courage. Mr. Levy is happy to take some questions. We do have some roving microphones, so we will start down the front here.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for the picture you gave to us, what's going on there, where I hope and I'm sure most of us will know. But I'd like to point a few things and a question. Israel is the hyena of the United States. And not only that now anymore, a lot of countries all around the world, they support Israel. Like Obama, when he was not very happy about a few things with Israel, he cut a little bit of the money, but he still gave to them hundreds of millions of dollars. Israel is the nuclear puppet of the United States. And not only the United States. I'm talking about from personal experience. Greece is a puppet of Israel. Cyprus is a puppet. The last week, we have in Greece one big celebration of our prize in the university. And Israel with Greece, and in the United States, they have an exercise how to invade Iran. As we said before about Iran, the thing is Israel has coordinated with Saudi Arabia. But the point is, Israel, without the support financially and everything from the United States and the rest of the West, England, France, Greece, Cyprus, or whatever, the question is, do you agree we have to speak 12 governments to stop supporting. Thank you.
First of all, I'm not sure I'm sharing your view that Israel is a puppet of the United States. Many times I think it's the opposite way around. And I'm really not joking. After 8 years of an Obama administration, a man who really, whose heart was for sure in the right place, who really knew the situation, who really knew something about the Palestinian fate, and so little was done, nothing was done, I really start to ask myself, what is the American interest in supporting Israel? And I start to think in many times that it's the opposite way around, my friends. And really, if someone watches their relationship between Israel and the United States, many times you ask yourself, who is exactly the puppet? And this lip service of condemning the settlements, and as I say, the United States could have done so much more, so much more. Israel was never depending so much on the United States in any possible way. And yes, I think that supporting Israel, as I say, supporting the policy of Israel, supporting the occupation, is something that you should raise your voice against, absolutely.
Hello, my name's Ruba. I was recently in Palestine and in the Israeli areas, and I was very confused by the town of Lifta. And I would like you to explain the situation to me, because I can't understand why I found a sign which said, once we were pioneers and now we are squatters. And you said that the settlers are the ones that are holding the government to ransom. I'm wondering, because they are settlers, the people in Lifta. And
in
now they're
the people who are settlers.
In Lifta, in Jerusalem?
Yes, in Lifta, sure.
Lifta. And they're now being evicted, from my understanding, so that construction companies can come in and build in that beautiful historic town. And I don't understand why these settlers that are now considered squatters or illegal, but they're Israeli citizens, and they're Jewish Israeli citizens. I don't understand that situation.
I wish this would be our problem. Lifta.
But what I mean is, the Israeli government is turning on its own people.
No, not at all.
No?
No, in this case, not at all. And that's almost the only evacuation of Jewish people in Israel and in the occupied territories. It's all about real estate there. There's a very small group of Jewish Israelis. Most of the houses, as you saw it, are just ruins. Maybe the most beautiful Palestinian village ever. Maybe the most beautiful village on earth. But most of the houses were kept as ruins. There were some houses in which Israelis lived, Jewish Israelis. They went there half legally, half illegally in 48, and they stayed there half legally, half not legally. And now they evacuate them, they supply them with compensations, quite a lot of compensation, in order to build there another monster of real estate, that's all. Don't count on this, unfortunately.
Thanks very much. You talk about equal rights for Palestinians and Israelis, but I wanted to hear more about your perspective on the 20% within Israel, i.e. the...
If you could just speak a little slower.
Sorry, I just wanted to hear in particular your take on the 20% inside Israel, i.e. the Palestinian citizens of Israel, in that to date we can almost characterize Israel without the occupation regime as an apartheid state, in that Palestinians inside Israel also don't enjoy equal rights whatsoever. So to what extent should we then use that as the sort of the start of a broader approach to how Palestinians are treated? Because surely we have to start with how Israeli citizens themselves are treated. And given that Israel itself already has an apartheid regime within, to what extent do you see change at that level within the 20%? And is that then linked to the broader occupation regime? Thank you.
I think if we turn to the dream, if we turn to the utopia, of a one democratic state, and right now it is still a dream. I claim that we have to start to make it real, but it will be a very long way to go. But if this is the dream, that's the ultimate answer to your question. Because in this one state, unlikely in the two-state solution in which Israeli Palestinians will continue to live under discrimination, in this one democratic state, everyone will be equal. And if there are some disadvantages to the two-state solution, and there are, one of them is really what will be about the Israeli Palestinians, because they will remain under Zionist discriminative regime. So the ultimate model should be a democracy with equal rights to all its citizens, Jewish, Palestinian, Israeli Palestinians, occupied territories Palestinians, all the Palestinians. Did it answer your question? Thank you.
Levi, thank you. My name is Samia Jabour. You mentioned what could Israel possibly do about the evacuation of 700,000 settlers from the occupied territories. I'm not supporting a two-state solution, but I'd like to point out that more than 700,000 Palestinians were evacuated from the land by Israel previously in the Nakba of 1948. I'd like to also mention the title of your talk today, The First 50 Years of Occupation. You mentioned the need to change the discourse. I'd like to counter that by saying that there have been 69 years of occupation. And also, you mentioned the three regimes of Israel. I'd like to offer a fourth, which is an immigration policy that allows the displaced millions of the 1948 Nakba the right of return. So I wonder if you could comment on that, please.
You really touched, obviously, the core issues, and I'm not sure that we have a solution for each of them. And again, I believe that we will get closer to total justice. There will be no total justice. Because if you mean by the right of return, the return of all the refugees to their original homes and fields and villages, then you have a new community of 6 million Jews who will be refugees. And you create a new injustice or a new problem. And finally, by the end of the day, we want to get to some kind of solution. So there will be no total justice. But the closest we can get will be, in my view, the one state in which Palestinians and Jews will have the right to immigrate or to return to the land, not exactly to their own homes, not exactly to the villages. There will be a government, a joint government of Palestinians and Jews, who will decide about the immigration policy like any other state in the world. No state in the world let everyone in. There will be no privileges for Jews, And we will try to make as many Palestinians as possible return to new places. It will not be the old places. You mentioned the 700,000 who went through the ethnic cleansing. Don't forget that they were totally helpless then. The settlers are much, much stronger, as I tried to describe. And no Israeli government will evacuate them by force like we did it to the Palestinians in 48. So this comparison doesn't apply, because by the end of the day, they are a very, very strong community, while the Palestinians, unfortunately, in 48 were quite helpless. And we should really, and this is a suggestion for all of us, we should really think about as close as we can get to the total justice. But we will never reach a total justice, because there was a crime, and not every crime can be, not every history cannot always repair and correct every crime.
Thank you very much for your very inspirational and strong advocacy for.
Someone shuts your mouth.
I think you've really shown that you are really a Jew of great compassion. And during World War II, Jewish people called those who helped Jews escape the Nazis to be called righteous Jews. I think we can call you a righteous Jew today. My question is, how do we, as Australians, do more to give solidarity to the people of Palestine and to help change the situation? It seems to me that in dealing with that whole question, one of the big issues is, of course, that the two major political parties in this country are so locked in to US military policy that it's very hard to get a change. But I was just wondering if you had any ideas that you could share with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I hardly know what should I do. So you want me to tell others what to do and to tell Australians what to do. And still, I think that so much can be done. First of all, to make people aware, to make people know. Because in this country, like in many other countries in the West, people don't know the truth. Even your politicians don't know the truth. They all are invited by the Jewish lobby to come to see the miracle of Israel. And they don't see the whole picture. They see only what the Israelis want them to see. And they sell them all the Israeli propaganda, which part of it is totally, totally fake. And your role, if I may say so, is first of all to create awareness and information. Let people know what's going on there. I believe that such a nice people like the Australians, no way they will remain indifferent if they will know what's going on there. No way that those lovely people will just say, yeah, that's the way it should be. Don't spoil my image of Australia. I know you are carrying your past, but let me at least this piece, keep it for me at least until the end of this visit. I still want to believe that you are wonderful. Don't spoil it. And in any case, the other way is really trying, you know, to put pressure on politicians. It is still a democracy here. And also politicians in this part of the world should know that not only to become critical of Israel takes a price here with the Jewish lobby, but maybe also the opposite can be. And if you are so anti-Palestinian, anti-justice, not anti-Palestinian, if you are so anti-justice, you will pay a political price here. I want to say something. The Jewish lobby everywhere is using the same methods, labeling any criticism of Israel as anti-Semitism. It's going all over the world, it's extremely efficient, and it paralyzes you. Please don't get paralyzed. You can be a critic of Israel while having nothing to do with anti-Semitism. Raising a voice, a critical voice against Israel, against the occupation, has to do with consciousness, has to do with morality, has nothing to do with anti-Semitism.
Thank you very much for your speech.
That's okay. Just one moment.
Gideon, I've just got a quick question about invisibility. And in particular, the invisibility of the Palestinian people. We've got a similar situation here in Australia where recently, only a few years ago, we apologised to the Indigenous Australian population for effectively rendering them invisible for the time that we have been here. As you may be aware, Australia was founded on the principle of terra nullius, as to say that there were no people when the land was colonised by the English. Similarly, Palestine, or what is now modern-day Israel, was founded on the principles of invisibility. The Zionists perpetrated the myth that it was a land without a people for a people without a land. In the 70s, Golda Meir said that there was no such thing as the Palestinian people. And even recently, a member of the Knesset said that it was not possible that there could be anything such as Palestinians because the letter P doesn't exist in the Arabic language. When we apologised to our Indigenous population here, what we did was we acknowledged their visibility. And so, in so doing, what we did was we agreed upon a common narrative and a common understanding of the past. And in so doing, it created the potential for a common dialogue for the future. How can we create a common narrative, a common understanding of the past with the Israelis so as to create a common dialogue and hope for the future?
I'm one of the believers that first we have to reach some kind of political change before all the rest, like it was also in South Africa. First, there was the end of the apartheid. Then came the committees, the truth and, how you call it, truth and? You say. We cannot, this right now, you have no partner for this in Israel. And maybe also not in Palestine, by the way. Very rightly so. I don't think you have right now partners to start to speak about a new future, and we have first of all to change the political or the reality before changing the reality in which a young Palestinian have no perspective for his future, who is humiliated on a daily basis, whose parents are humiliated on a daily basis, who in any possible night the army can come and kidnap him. Hundreds of months are kidnapped every month, hundreds of people, most of them without any reason. So we have first to change this reality. No social or other processes will take place before changing the reality. There are those who think first we have to change the values and then we'll go. This is too long to go, and I don't see this is happening. By the end of the day, we have to start first to change the reality before anything else. And yes, then will come the day. I remember, without comparing at all to the Nazis, I never compare Israel to the Nazis or the Israeli army to the Nazis, but I remember when Willy Brandt, the Chancellor of Germany, came to Israel, went to Yad Vashem, which is the big memorial for the Holocaust, and leaned in front of the memorial there, it had a bigger effect than many, many other things. I always thought the day that there will be an Israeli prime minister who will go to the Palestinian parliament and who would not only take responsibility but also ask for forgiveness for all those years. This will be a huge step. But who do you want to do it? Any Israeli politician who will do it today will commit suicide. We have to change this.
Yes, Gideon, thank you. We here in Australia were enlightened a couple of months ago by a book by John Lyons, who I'm sure you know, who is the journalist of The Australian in Jerusalem, A Balcony Over Jerusalem. And we learnt of the pressures that he, as a journalist, was placed under here in Australia to pull his stories, basically. And I thought of you, and I told you last night, I've read you for many years. Can you tell us something about the pressures that you have been under as a journalist in Israel who is telling the alternative story?
First of all, I'm not sure that I have an issue. In any case, I'm not a victim of anything. I still gain total freedom of speech because I'm Jewish, because I'm a journalist. I have this unbelievable platform called Haaretz, which not only gives me the space, but also supports me. I pray every day to the good health of my publisher many times they call him and complain about me, the readers, and you know what he tells them? You know what, maybe Haaretz is not a newspaper for you. And he loses another subscriber. We really have to cross our fingers for this newspaper who lost, they claim, 2 million shekels. It's like 500,000 American dollars. Only over one article I wrote on the Israeli pilots in the last operation in Gaza in terms of cancellation of subscription and advertisements. I'm the most hated person in the commercial department. I never go in the area of the commercial department, and still I get all the support in the world. In other words, I don't take it for granted. It will change. If this government will continue, this will change. We are the next target. They started with the NGOs, with the Supreme Court. They will get to us, no doubt. They claimed it already. They are going to get to us. But at least until now, I never faced any pressure from the government, from the secret services, from anything. It's not very pleasant to walk with me in the streets of Tel Aviv. I can survive. Catherine was spit once in the market of Tel Aviv. She claims that it was aimed at her. I claim it was aimed at me, but anyhow, she got it, not me. And we had towels and we cleaned it and we overcame even this. There are some unpleasant moments. As I said, I had the bodyguards for a while, but they were settlers, which makes it much more complicated for me because they were more against me than the others. But in any case, it's not a big issue. I can still gain my total freedom abroad and in Israel. I don't take it for granted, but until now, this must be said, and I highly appreciate it, until now.
Two more questions. Sorry.
Thank you very much for a very courageous presentation and for your persistence and hope. I have a question about, you talked about change, especially in your answers. I'm just wondering whether there is a way of influencing change through education within Israel, or whether there are any schools, whether private or government, where there's some change in the curriculum about the perception of the Palestinians. Because I know in Egypt and Jordan, after the peace process, there were negotiations initiated by Israel to omit references which were perceived as negative to Jews and Israel. I know this is a big shock, but if there is a long shot, but if there is a way for hope and change through education. Thank you.
In one word, no. In more words, the education system is right now run by the leader of the most extreme party, the most extreme nationalistic settlers party. He is the Minister of Education. As I say, the mood is going only to their direction, and there is a change, but only for the worse in the education system. And I can't see anyone, I mean, teachers are fired for writing in their private Facebook page that they support justice. This is enough to fire a teacher today. We are really facing mechanism like we never faced before. I'm speaking about facts. People who support the asylum seekers struggle. Now, a principal, a headmaster of a school who supported the asylum seekers is about to be fired. So in this atmosphere, you can't expect anything, no. It will not come in a good way. I'm very sorry to say so.
Last question here.
Gideon, do Israelis believe that after almost a century of resistance by the Palestinians, they will give up? Do they believe the Palestinians will capitulate? Otherwise, you know, what's their hope? That to live in war for the rest of eternity?
I can't speak on behalf of all Israelis, obviously, and I don't know what's going on in their minds. I can only have my appreciation. First of all, and maybe the worst of all, they don't deal with it. They don't think about it. They have no vision for the future. They don't know where we are going to. There is no goal. There's no end game. We are just living the present. And this is new. This was not until 10, 15 years ago. There's no goal. We'll continue and we will see what happens. Maybe there will be a miracle, and one way or the other, the Palestinians will just vanish. Something will happen. Others still believe that maybe a transfer will be possible throughout the war. Maybe the Palestinians will give up and we will tyrannize their lives so much that they will voluntarily, so to say, leave. At least some of the Israelis believe in it. Therefore, they support this occupation because it's really making the Palestinians living in a hell. But there is no clear answer because Israelis don't deal with the future, most of them not. And the politicians don't have any answers for their future, nothing. And unfortunately, there is no one to ask, to raise the question, where are we going to? I always say, don't argue with the right-wingers, don't argue with the silent majority, just ask them, where are we going to? And you will never get an answer. I want to say one more sentence before I say goodbye. I can't tell you how challenging it was to be here today. I want just a last remark. Many times people will tell you the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, if you call it conflict, because I'm not sure it's a conflict, it's the Israeli occupation. There was no French-Algerian conflict. There was a French occupation, colonization. But many times you hear, oh, you make it oversimplified. You draw it in black and white. It is so much more complex. And that's the way of people really to break away from the truth. And the truth is that it is black and white. And it is simple. And it's very, very simple to see who's the right one, who's the wrong one. Thank you very much.
Finally, invite Dr. Manuva and Asaluddin to close proceedings.
Thank you very much for a very sobering yet powerful account of what your views are, what you're experiencing on a day-to-day basis. No doubt you've enlightened us further and we'll continue with the cause. Everyone, thank you very much for being here this evening. Without your support and your ongoing attendance to this lecture, this annual lecture, no doubt it wouldn't go ahead. So we're very grateful for your interest and we hope to see you next year. Just one last account, recap rather, just a reminder, Gideon has kindly agreed to sign books outside in the foyer, so feel free to linger, have a look at the books that are on sale and meet Gideon himself. And also, if you are interested in hearing him further, there is still an opportunity to register for tomorrow's symposium. Thank you and good night.